Thank you for the invitation. It is a pleasure to present the experience from more than 9 years of screening families in the our clinics, in the outpatient clinics, regarding sudden arrhythmic death syndrome. So what is sudden arrhythmic death syndrome? What is SADS? With SADS, we define a death which is non-traumatic, it's a natural sudden death, and which remains unexplained after an autopsy, after especially histopathological and toxicology screen. And it's important and is recommended, if it's available, to the autopsy to be performed by an expert cardiac pathologist. Why are we focusing on SADS? We discussed all this morning about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, idiopathic left ventricular hypertrophy, but you can see that SADS has been increasingly identified as the number one cause of death, both in series and registers of athletes, but also in national-wide registries or region-based registries. So you can see here that it represents up to 40% of the cases of sudden cardiac death. In 2013, these three heart rhythm societies published the recommendations about the follow-up and the clinical evaluation and genetic evaluation of after a sudden cardiac death, and SADS plays a big role in this document. For the purpose of this talk, I will just focus on the clinical evaluation of the families, which is, as you can see here, a class one indication. And this is reasonable because we know the first study was performed in 2003 regarding clinical evaluation of families, that if you bring the families after a sudden cardiac death and you screen the first degree relatives, you can get an inherited cardiac disease in a significant proportion of these cohorts. And we can see that there's a great disparity, the percentages from 13% up to 52% have been reported. And this is mainly because of the different methodologies and different protocols, clinical protocols that all these studies have used. So I'm gonna present our experience from over 300 families and over 900 relatives that have attended outpatient clinics after a sudden cardiac death with a normal autopsy. This is almost a nine years follow-up prospective evaluation. And we use a one-stop-shop model, meaning that the families come in the morning, they have all their tests done, and they don't need usually to come for a second visit. We used an extended clinical protocol, and I'll put a bit of focus on that. Initial evaluation of the relatives included, personal and family history, with special focus on the circumstances of death, a clinical and physical examination, and a series of non-invasive tests, which included a resting ECG, an echocardiogram, an exercise test, and a standard 24-hour Holter. With this initial investigation, we were able to identify conditions that can be identified through this investigation, such as long QT syndrome, CPVT, or people that had a spontaneous type 1 Brugada pattern. But in case this investigation were normal, or when there were a high suspicion of Brugada syndrome, we performed a sodium channel blocker provocation testing, which in our institutions is a NADS-Balin provocation test. When there were abnormal or findings suggestive of cardiomyopathy, we performed a cardiac MRI, and again, if this didn't give us the diagnosis, we performed again a NADS-Balin provocation testing. Some additional investigations at genetic screening has been also performed. So these are the characteristics of our probands. This 70% of the cohort were males. The mean age was 28.1 years. You can see by definition, all the cases were autopsied, and nearly half of the cases were had an expert pathology by Professor Mary Shepherd. The majority of victims died during their sleep or at rest. And you can see that's really interesting that only a minority of these people had symptoms in their lives or a family history of sudden cardiac death. we were able to evaluate more than one relative in 74% of the families. This is our diagnostic yield in the familial level. 42% of the families were identified with an inherited cardiac disease. The vast, vast majority of the diagnoses were primary ion channelopathies, with the predominant diagnosis of Brugada syndrome in 28% of the families, followed by long QT syndrome in 7% of the families. Structural heart disease was identified in 3.3% of the families. The same applies for the relatives level. Almost one quarter, one out of four people that attended our clinics left the clinic with a diagnosis of inherited cardiac disease. And again, the vast majority were that of Brugada syndrome. The only predictor of diagnosis in this cohort was investigating more than one relative. So bigger families had more frequently a diagnosis. What did we do with the people identified with inherited cardiac disease? Lifestyle advice was given to all patients, especially in regards to avoidance of specific medications that prolong QT or can exacerbate Brugada phenotype, aggressive treatment of fever in those with Brugada syndrome. Medical therapy was initiated in 35 relatives, mainly those of long QT syndrome with beta blockers. An ICD was implanted in 28 relatives, and two relatives had a permanent pacemaker. So if we go back on the previous studies and our study, you will see that consistently in all previous studies, long QT syndrome has been identified with the blue bars. CPVT also is present in most of the studies, but you can see a great disparity here. So we found 28% of our families having Brugada syndrome, where in previous studies, this yield comes as zero, maximum to 9%. So how can we explain this disparity? How can we explain the high prevalence of Brugada syndrome? So if you look in this graph, you will see that with the orange line, is the use of asthmalin provocation testing in previous studies. This ranges from 10 to 20, maximum 30%, where in our case, at least 85% of the families had at least one relative having an asthmalin provocation testing. So this, in fact, increased a lot of our yield. And it's particularly relevant because only four relatives had a spontaneous type 1 Brugada pattern. So 97.5 would have been missed if we didn't do an asthmalin provocation testing. And in addition to that, 28% of people diagnosed with Brugada syndrome had a perfectly, completely normal ECG, not even suggestive of Brugada syndrome, not a type 2 or type 3, a completely normal baseline ECG. So, side to the systematic use of asthmalin testing, we also used the high intercostal space lead. So we placed, and you can see here with the yellow bars that this added an additional 16% in our yield. And how we did that? So we placed the leads V1 and V2 in the third and the second intercostal space. And in 49 families and 92 individuals, people that had a non-diagnostic Brugada pattern in the conventional leads in the fourth intercostal space revealed a clear type 1 Brugada pattern in the second intercostal space. So using high intercostal leads significantly increased our yield. This is an example from one of our patients. This is his baseline ECG. This is the brother of a victim of sudden death who died at the age of 28 during his sleep. And you can see here during the asthmalin, inside the red circles is the conventional V1 and V2 leads. But if you look with the black arrows, these are the V1 and V2 leads in the second intercostal space. So if we haven't used this, if we haven't used these leads here, we will get a negative asthmalin test. So we'll wouldn't give a diagnosis to this patient. So there is a discussion, I will briefly come to that. Are these actually maybe false positive results? And this discussion comes from studies that reported up to a 5%, 4.5% of adrenaline tests which were positive in healthy control, so otherwise normal people that came for a study. And then we have the experience from Netherlands where when they did an asthmaline, then in 8% of their positive asthmalines after a sudden death, then when they went to the families, there was a different genetic diagnosis, nothing to do with Brugada, and there was a failure of segregation. So they said possibly this 8% is not true positive asthmalines. I just want to point out that in all of these cases, they did a different protocol than the one that we use. So when they had a borderline case that was Brugada, but not clearly diagnosed Brugada, they infused a bit more of adrenaline. And this is particularly relevant because in all these 8% of their cases, they used more than 1 milligram per kilogram dose of adrenaline. So we have some data that we can say that what we present is true positive adrenaline tests, and this comes from genetic testing, which was similar to what is previously reported in Brugada syndrome. 38% of the families were found with more than one relative with Brugada syndrome, and there were no significant differences when we compared people that manifested the type 1 in the normal compared to the high intercostal speed leads. We have also some follow-up data in this Brugada syndrome patient, and I would just point out that 17% of these people that have a concealed Brugada syndrome, so in theory they are low risk, had in follow-up, which was a 4.3 years mean follow-up, either a syncope, an presumed arrhythmic syncope, non-sustained ventricular tachycardia, and we also had a sudden cardiac death. So altogether, 17% of this cohort changed its risk or had an event in follow-up. So coming to the end, this is ongoing work. So we are including families up to 2018, and the cohort now has increased in more than 400 families. And I will just pick up on the age and the gender difference in SADS. So very briefly, I would just like to say that if we split our SADS cohort in young, in pediatric victims, in young and in people that died over 35 years old, we see a trend both in the etiology but also in the clinical yield of what we are getting from our investigation. So basically, the older the victim, we get less clinical yield, we get less cases of CPVT and Brugada syndrome, and you can see in here, in the over 35s, Brugada syndrome pretty much is what we get. We don't get any other diagnosis. And there were also some gender differences. Male victims were more frequently diagnosed with Brugada syndrome, where in female victims had more frequently long QT syndrome. So concluding, an evaluation of all FESTIC relatives in young victims of sudden cardiac death is recommended, and this is mainly to prevent further tragedies. When we evaluate a family after SADS, an adrenaline test with the use of high intercostal leads should be performed. And when we deal with these families, we should be very careful in writing down what is the age, the gender, and the characteristics of the death. Thank you very much for your attention.